I organize these lectures once every semester together with the help of our program manager at the Women and Gender Studies program, Emily Nail. The lecture series once a semester on a topic that pertains to women in the developing world, understood broadly. Okay, so we are very lucky to have Professor Sherene Seikaly today to give us a talk with this title. But today also marks the International Women's Day. And for those of you who might have forgotten, March 8th is the International Women's Day, where we are expected globally to pause and think about structured inequalities that that women everywhere in the first world, in the third world, developing world, underdeveloped, all of those worlds experience on a daily basis, especially working women, because the origins of the day go back to workers, the labor movement, right? I am not going to be doing the introductions because we are very lucky to have someone who is going to introduce Sherene. Professor Syed Atchan is with us today. He is a visiting assistant professor of peace and conflict studies at Swarthmore College. He holds a PhD from Harvard University's Department of Anthropology, where he wrote a dissertation about the politics of international humanitarian aid to Palestinians. This dissertation, which was defended rather recently, is already under contract as a book manuscript with Stanford University Press. He has worked in the past for American Civil Liberties Union, the UN High Commissioner on Refugees, Human Rights Watch, Seeds of Peace, the Palestinian Negotiations Affairs Department, and the government of Dubai. Without further ado, I would like to invite Professor Atchan to introduce
Thank
Sherene.
You so much.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much for having me. It's an honor to introduce Sherene Seikaly, Assistant Professor of History at the University of California, Santa Barbara. She previously served as Assistant Professor of History and Director of the Middle East Studies Center at the American University in Cairo. Dr. Seikaly has had postdoctoral fellowships in Germany as well as at Georgetown University. Seikaly earned her PhD in History and Middle Eastern Studies from New York University, an MA in Arab Studies from Georgetown, and a BA in Urban Studies and Anthropology from the University of California, San Diego. Dr. Seikaly has taught a range of exciting courses on the history of Palestine-Israel, liberalism and neoliberalism in the Arab world, and the body and revolution in the Middle East, among other courses. She's also invited to deliver public lectures at universities across the US and abroad, as well as for more general audiences. Just to name a few examples, these topics have included the women's movement and Islam, Lebanese films, Egyptian politics, and human rights and political economy in the Middle East. Thus, while Seikaly's scholarship is deeply grounded in economic and social history and in the context of Palestine, she is truly a public intellectual with invaluable insights on the broader contemporary Middle East region as well. Seikaly's publication record is inspiring, with peer-reviewed journal articles, book chapters, book reviews, and articles that have been useful for scholars and non-academic audiences alike. She is the editor of the Arab Studies Journal, co-founder and co-editor of Jadaliya e-Zine, and editor of the Journal of Palestine Studies. She's also published in academic journals such as the International Journal of Middle East Studies and the Journal of Middle East Women's Studies as well as in online venues including Jadaliya, Mada Masir, and Hibir. Seikaly's book, Men of Capital, Scarcity and Economy in Mandate Palestine, was published this year by Stanford University Press. I strongly recommend the book. I wouldn't be here otherwise. And Men of Capital explores how Palestinian capitalists and British colonial officials used the economy to shape territory, nationalism, the home, and the body. It is a remarkable text focused on the British Mandate period in Palestine. Seikaly writes that the early 20th century Palestine was a dynamic time of cultural and literary production, as well as a period of significant social transformation that included an active women's movement, labor organizing, mass mobilization, and popular politics. She presents new insights on how we can conceptualize the economic sphere, colonialism, and pan-Arab imaginaries at this time. Seikaly's scholarship contributes to the historiography of Palestine in important ways by unearthing from the archives the role of Palestinian capitalists. I was particularly struck by Seikaly's challenging of conventional logics that have linked Arab nationalism merely to socialism, or, for example, the association of Christian Palestinians to social inequalities. Furthermore, Seikaly examines how gender intersects with class and nation in this context. Today, we will hear a bit more about that portion of her breathtaking book, as well as other important themes in her talk entitled Women of Thrift, Men of Capital, Gender and Economy in Palestine. I must add that in addition to being a brilliant scholar, Seikaly has been a tremendous inspiration, ally, and generous mentor to many students and colleagues, including myself, in history and Middle East studies. So please join me in welcoming Sherene Seikaly.
Thank you so much. Is the mic working? Yes? Okay, thank you so much for that over-generous welcome, Said. I'm so grateful and humbled to you. And I also really want to thank Lerna, who I met when we were both graduate students at NYU, which is starting to feel like it was a long time ago. Time passes very quickly, unfortunately. I also really want to thank Emily, who has put together a number of events in the coming couple of days. And I did want to mention tomorrow there's going to be a film screening of an important new Palestinian film called Speed Sisters, which is sort of tracks the journeys of women speed car drivers in the West Bank. So please do join us if you have time tomorrow at 7.
And 6120.
Building 6, room 120, right? Yes, in the Infinite Hall. Is that what? Yes. Okay, so today I'm going to be talking about basically the issues of gender, capital, and economy. And I'm also going to be touching on another portion of the series that Lerna and Emily put together, which is to think and reflect on what do we mean when we talk about the notion of development. And forgive me if my voice falters. I've been sort of struggling with a bit of a cold, but I'm in denial that I have a cold, so we'll see. In British-ruled Palestine, Palestinian elites and British colonial officials attempted to define and regulate a category that will be very important for me in the next 40 minutes, which is that of basic needs. This process had varying consequences for both economic thought as well as everyday practices. In the 1930s, against the backdrop of armed rebellion and the Great Depression, Palestinian elites, who I'm here referring to as men of capital and women of thrift, distinguished between needs and luxuries. This was part of a broader attempt to realize a pan-Arab utopia, as well as specific gendered subjectivities. As the decade wore on and World War II came to Palestine, these men and women, with their emphasis on growth and accumulation, confronted a landscape of commercial paralysis and a crisis of supply. The scarcity of basic goods such as wheat, rice, and flour, and the specter of political disorder, together inspired the British colonial government to introduce new forms of economic management. Through institutions such as the Middle East Supply Center, British colonial rule attempted to configure new regional territories. In Palestine, an ambitious rationing regime relied on new indices such as the calorie that would determine people's bare minimum and assure, hopefully, food for all. So I'm going to be reconstructing these instances so that I can think together with you about Palestinian and British visions of progress, of ideal gendered subjectivities, of territories, of development. And in doing so, I want to reveal the divergent but of overlapping attempts to shape economy as an object of knowledge and as a site of social management. So my talk today is taken from my book, which Said so generously described. And he's taken, some of my talk will sound familiar because he's talked about a lot of the main things that are most important to me in the work. And I'm happy to talk more about it in our discussion. I'm going to walk you through what I'll do today, which is first I'm going to tell you about the Palestinian elites that I study. I want to contextualize them historically and explain why they're important and how they can complicate how we've understood Palestinian history. And then I'm going to draw on some of these narratives of the 1930s to show how basic needs is this really central category. I'll be putting that in conversation with British colonial attempts to manage the Palestinian economy. In doing so, I'm going to be thinking together with you about how is it that scarcity and its management are really central to constructions of economy. And in the final part of my talk, I'll be reflecting a little bit on the so what question. Why do these stories matter? Why do they matter to the history of Palestine, to the history of the Middle East, and beyond? So before we start our story, let me briefly just review British rule in Palestine, which begins just after World War I. This is what Ottoman Palestine looked like. This is one of my favorite maps because it's color-coded, and it explains many things that otherwise aren't visible. Okay. What happens after World War I is that the League of Nations declares Palestine a Class A mandate. This is a form of temporary rule that would parent the Ottoman Empire's former Arab provinces into eventual independence. This form of rule really relied on an infantilizing idea that the people of the former Ottoman Empire, the former Arab provinces, were not yet old enough to rule themselves. And the mandate system was also very racialized. And so there were gradations. The Arab provinces got graded grade A, whereas many of the African provinces of the former Austro-Hungarian and German empires got graded grade C, so less able than the Arabs to rule themselves. This is a very kind of core part of how we think about liberalism as an infantilizing discourse of knowledge and practice. Now, what was unique to the Palestine mandate was the Balfour Declaration. The Balfour Declaration was issued in 1917 and was at the juridical core of British mandate rule in Palestine. The declaration committed the British government to facilitating a Jewish national home in Palestine. Most crucially, it defined the Arab majority by what they were not. So they were defined as non-Jewish, whose civil and religious rights the British colonial government committed to safeguarding. What this Balfour Declaration then does, it becomes the core of all of the British legislative tools that rule Palestine until 1948. And what it does from its inception is make impossible the possibility of Palestinian politics. So the way we think about the Balfour Declaration is often in nationalist terms, but actually what it does is erase the possibility of collective political demands. In the late 19th century, European Jewish settlers began heeding the call of the Zionist movement. And this movement is very significant because it poised itself as a refuge from centuries of anti-Semitism, persecution, and ultimately genocide. European Jews are almost absent in the Palestinian narratives I study in the 1930s and appear only as antagonistic forces in the 1940s. This is very surprising given that European Jewish immigration, which began in 1878 and accounted then for only 3% of the people in Palestine, had risen exponentially by 1933, due in large part, of course, to the Nazi rise to power in Germany. The absence of European Jews in these narratives that I study is also conspicuous because it was in the 1930s that Palestinians sustained a three-year revolt against British colonialism and European Jewish settlement. So despite these dynamics, it's not until the 1940s that I began to see Palestinian businessmen and reformers really addressing European Jews and Zionism as a threat to their presence. So one of the questions I sort of started out asking is, how can we account for this narrative dissonance? And one of the ways to account for it, I believe, is to tell this story of how these elite Palestinian men and women were really attempting to carve out economy as a distinct sphere of theory and action. So as a lot of other contemporaries around them, these people were very invested in describing the object they sought to, in creating the object they sought to distinguish. And part of doing that was a very insistent attempt to constantly distinguish between the political and the economic. And this is a very modernist impulse, right, to constantly distinguish and categorize. And what is interesting about this particular story is that it is not until that separation of the economic from the political, and it is only when that separation becomes impossible, that Palestinian capitalists are then forced to engage European Jews as this threatening presence in the 1940s. So before detailing the work of these elites, let me now turn to just talking a little bit about what these men of capital and these women of thrift can contribute to historiography. So bear with me, there's gonna be some numbers, but it's okay. Everything's gonna be okay. It's all good. Malish. So the way that we traditionally think about Palestine under British rule is really in terms of paralysis, decline, passivity. The overwhelming focus has been on two notable families in Jerusalem, the Husseinis and the Nesheshibis. These guys have gotten a lot of press, and everybody knows their ins and outs. And the standard narrative is that these tax-collecting, land-owning families were inefficient, ineffective, not sufficiently anti-colonial, constantly fighting with each other, decadent, selfish. In juxtaposition to these elite figures, then we see a large mass of peasants who people heroize, but understand as ignorant. Okay, so they are the ignorant but heroic peasants. And then somewhere in between, there are a small group of active workers who are beginning to build alliances with leftist Zionists who are the proletariat that are going to lead us to the messianic revolution that Marx has inspired so many of us with. Unfortunately, life never looked like he thought it would look, but what can we do? So one of the things that really inspired my research on this work was that my belief and my commitment that the social topography of Palestinian life was much more complicated than these colonial affective categories could actually tell us. And over the last few decades, scholars have really complicated this topography. And they've highlighted mandatory Palestine, so we're talking here in 1918 to 1948, the period of British rule, as Said had said in his very generous introduction, as a time of literary and cultural production, as a time of active labor organizing, as a time of populist politics, a very active women's movement, right? But what has remained silent is any discussion of Arab capitalist practice. And elites and economic elites are reduced to either landowners or tax collectors. Palestinians and their investment in capital accumulation, foreign investment, national economic growth are then erased from the record. Why this happens, I'm happy to talk about a bit more in our discussion. What I want to say for now is that this erasure has a strong corollary in Zionist modernization narratives, which has posited two hermetically sealed, isolated, enclosed economies, the pre-modern Arab agricultural economy, embodied here in the figure of the camels, against the modern Jewish industrial sector embodied here by the electricity factory. So scholars have gone really far in chipping away at this kind of dual society model that underpins these narratives, but Palestinian elites, and this really drove me crazy, continue to appear as if not only are their practices staid and unchanging, but that you can easily discern all of these different class formations. So my imperative in beginning this research was that the disaggregation of these elites, the taking seriously of these elites in order to critique them, really the time was urgent to do that. I want to say, of course, that the disparities between urban elites and rural Palestinians were everywhere to be seen. More certain still, the Zionist enterprise was richer and more equipped than any Palestinian industrial initiative. Indeed, European Jews go from generating 50% of Palestine's output in the 1920s to 60% in the early 1930s, and finally to 80% during wartime-induced industrialization in the 1940s. But the corollary of this growth was not Palestinian economic stagnancy. It was something altogether different. And I'm now going to just give you some of the numbers I'm worried that I might lose you with about how, what do we do with this historically constructed commercial class. So in the late Ottoman period, we are already seeing a commercial class that is separate from the landed elite really coming into its own in Palestine. There are new opportunities in foreign firms like banks, trade bureaus, shipping companies, commercial agencies, and these opportunities are expanding an already growing group of shop owners, distributors, retailers. You're seeing the consolidation of different kinds of professions, such as teachers, journalists, lawyers, civil servants, who are benefiting and engaging in new opportunities in printing, commerce, and trade that are taking place. By World War I, there's a wide variety of industries, and these include flour milling, soap making, metal shops. Between 1918 and 1927, you have Palestinians and European Jews establishing over 2,300 commercial and manufacturing enterprises. 60% of these are Palestinian owned. By the 1930s, Palestine has become one of the most prosperous economies in the Middle East, and capital investment in this period reaches £2 million. And here we're talking about tobacco, soap, milling, and a growing textile industry. Now, the real growth takes place during World War II, which is kind of understandable because basically the British are turning Palestine into a military base. And during this period, you see both the number of Arab industrial establishments and their workforce more than doubling. So just in a period of a few years. Palestinians also had considerable cash in the two Arab banks, which expanded faster in the 1940s than any other financial institution in Palestine at the time. And here we are talking about how between 1939 and 1946, total capital in the Arab Bank and the Arab National Bank increases almost 14-fold. So clearly there's a story to tell here. And to tell this story, we have to step out of the faulty comparison between Palestinians and European Jews, and I can talk in the discussion about why I think that's a faulty comparison. And we have to also step out of the idea that we can collapse all of Palestinian or Middle Eastern elites into a simple understanding of a landed gentry, or what many people anachronistically called the aristocracy. It's a very problematic term. Okay, so now I want to go to the third part of my talk, which is I'm going to talk to you a little bit about these junctures in the production of economy as a distinct and separate space, right? This modernist impulse of distinguishing the economy from the political, and how that takes place and why that's important. So what I look at in the 1930s are periodicals and radio programs of these elite projects. And I look to see how they are doing this shaping of economy as a sphere of action. One of the things I studied is a journal that had not yet been studied called Al-Iqtisadiyat Al-Arabiya, which means Arab Economic Affairs. And this is a very interesting journal in which in the 1930s, a group of these men are basically writing on economic affairs and how they understand economic affairs. They're translating from the economists. They're doing very, very interesting things. Iqtisadiyat, as I will refer to it, hits the presses in 1935. Its editor-in-chief was a man named Fuad Saba. He had an editorial team, all who self-defined as economists, which is very interesting. And I can talk to you about the genealogy of their education in the discussion. And while it's really hard to actually trace readership and literacy in this period, we know that in the 1930s, the dailies of this time were selling anywhere between 4,000 and 7,000 copies a day. And newspapers are circulating in multiple different ways, orally, in public spaces, they're being read out loud. And this journal begins as a bi-monthly, and it continues as a weekly until 1937, when the British exile Fuad Saba, who is who is the first licensed accountant in Mandate Palestine, and who has a company that is still ongoing until today called Saba and Company. And basically, they exile this editor-in-chief because he is funding the rebels of the 1936-1939 revolt. Now, this should have echoes for later Palestinian capitalist funding of armed resistance, which none of us have really looked at theoretically what that might mean. Despite the fact that these guys funded these rebels, they never featured the revolt on their pages. So not only are they not talking about European Jews, they're actually not talking about the rebellion that some of them are funding. And here again is this relentless division between the economic and the political. And these men are also defining themselves as distinct. They're saying, we are not men of politics. Those men are corrupt. They can do their own thing. We are men of capital, right? So who are these men? I want to give you a sense of who these people are because I spent a lot of time during my research responding to this very persistent claim and accusation that people give me, well, the people you're talking about don't exist. They never existed. There were no middle class. There was no entrepreneurial class. No, they never happened. It never happened. Okay, calm down. All right, first, take a breath. Secondly, let me give you a sense of who these people are and then who they become after 1948. So as I said, Saba establishes a very successful team of accountants. They're called Saba and Company. Others, like Abdel Hamid Shoman, founded the Arab Bank in 1930. The Arab Bank continues to be one of the most important banks in the Arab world. There are other corporations that actually begin in Palestine. Middle East Airlines, which is now based in Lebanon, Arabia Insurance, which is one of the largest insurance enterprises and ventures in the Arab world. And all of these firms basically reopen all throughout the Arab world after 1948. And this is the moment when Palestinians either become refugees or second-class citizens in the new state of Israel. As Palestine is falling, these men are rushing to guard their wealth. And what's very interesting about them is in the 1950s and 60s, these men would lead some of the largest and most successful insurance, engineering, banking, and contracting ventures in the Middle East, right? And so the conclusion here is not simply that there is a story to tell, but that this is a story that actually transcends historic divides and temporal divides that we really need to take seriously, right? And one of the main points that I'm trying to do in this work is not simply to deal with this flattened social topography that's very using all these colonial affects, but also to really try and critique Arab liberalism and to put forth the idea that economic thought and the politics of calculation and developmental politics are actually very crucial to what we have studied in Middle East and Arab studies, and that is the Arab Liberal Project or the Nahda Project. The Nahda Project, which beginning in the 19th and 20th centuries was a very heterogeneous movement which was sort of calling on the Arab nation to ostensibly arise and find its arrival to the modern. Most scholarship has looked at this phenomenon as one that is either literary or cultural. My point in this work is to say it was also an economic project. It had foundations in economic thought. And those foundations are ones we need to critique in order to understand the present. So let me tell you a little bit about this journal. Let me give you a sense of some of the titles that they featured. There were articles such as Economic Culture, The Position of Women in Economic Life, The Family Budget, Human Wants, Economy and Literature. And throughout all of these men of capital are basically proselytizing economics as a science of the self, as a discipline, as a code of conduct. They're basically trying to proselytize what is your relationship to money? What do you do with money and how is it related to your particular condition? The proliferation of needs and commodities was at the core of this project, of this economic Nahda or renaissance or awakening, quote unquote. Also important, private property, individual freedom, notions of self-responsibility, excitement about a compelling new world of towering buildings, cinema houses, cafes, restaurants. There's a lot of excitement. There's a lot of new objects for sale. And so one of the ways, and this is very interesting, that Palestinians, men of capital, are shaping this horizon of economic arrival is by representing the boundaries of the nation state, both textually and visually. And here you can see some of that visualization. In each issue, lead articles would follow financial news from the following categories. 1, Palestine and Transjordan. 2, North Africa. 3, Egypt and Sudan. 4, Iraq and the Arabian Peninsula. 5, Syria and Lebanon. And what they would include in this are things like commercial legislation, export and import figures, government budgets, custom rates. So what they're actually doing is rendering these various units both visible and calculable. Again, this is a very modernist impulse that is crucial to the understanding of economy as a sphere of regulation. How do you make things like the economy that are abstract, trackable, and manageable? Okay. One of the other interesting things that happens among these guys is that the idea of national income is ambivalent for them. In fact, for Selba and his team, the dissolution of the Ottoman Empire led to what they called oppressive economic conditions. They say that this dissolution erected unnatural boundaries on free trade that isolated Arab countries which had common bonds of language, religion, and tradition. So what's interesting about these guys is that they are presenting their readers, which who are regional, by the way, with the benefits of capital investment. They're including the nation state in that vision, but they're also really speaking to a broader regional understanding of capitalist utopia. And this is very interesting because the ways in which we have understood Pan-Arabism in Middle East studies has been linked to a socialist project. Okay, and this is a moment where actually you see these men who are very invested in profit, in capital accumulation, in private property. They are invested in understanding a regional realm of investment. What's important, however, is that not all that was new was beautiful for these elites. And they were very threatened. In fact, the specter of social change, which was everywhere around them, was very frightening for them. And here you see figures like the false intellectual and the true intellectual, the true men of capital. And the true men of capital are people who are judicious, they are authentic, they embrace technology, they encourage enterprise, and above all, they avoid ostentation. This avoiding of ostentation is very important to these projects. And also, there are two similarly contrasting women that appear in this landscape. One is the musrifa, or the spendthrift, and the other is the hasifa, or the judicious one. The spendthrift will be familiar to all of you. She's the one that spends all of her husband's money. He works hard, and she comes home, and she spent all of his money. The judicious one, however, is calculated. She's frugal, but she always is fashionable, right? She always has to be elegant. And what's interesting here is the gendered understandings of relationships to money and spending and capital. And so the idea is that women have this endemic consumer tendency. But what could be really useful is if you push that endemic tendency to domestic products and so benefit this new object, this new abstraction, the national economy, the woman is at her most sublime at the home. Which is this crucial space of moral containment. And what's interesting here is that men, too, have an endemic trait. And their endemic trait is a propensity for temptation. And here, there's all sorts of unspecified houses of entertainment that now preyed on men's natural propensity for temptation. Okay, so this is very interesting. So basically, it is women's responsibility in these domesticity projects to guard her men's fidelity. She is responsible for his loyalty and fidelity to her. And how does she do that? She keeps a clean, orderly, prudent, comfortable home. So the home, like the economy, becomes a space to be measured. It becomes a space to be calculated. It becomes the space to ensure prosperity. And in this instance, as in so many others, there's a spatializing of a national economy that is inextricable from demarcating the domestic as parallel but separate, right? And there's a program that I spent a lot of time studying. This is a photograph of a Palestinian Arab home. There's a radio program that I spent a lot of time studying and hating the woman who ran it, Salwa Saeed, and hating myself and hating domesticity because I heard so much of myself in this program. You know, as I was calculating my time, of course, because I work on a timer and that's how I discipline myself to get things done. So the politics of calculation are with us all the time. You know, my Fitbit is calculating everything as we speak. So this is really one of the important kind of impulses of how do you shape economy as this site. And what's really interesting about this program, nine-part radio series, which is called The New Arab Home, is in particular its relationship to a scientific domestic awakening that is really linked to new understandings of the household economy, as well as producing a quiet and contained individuality. So here the emphasis is on modern cooking techniques, hygiene, the keeping of ledgers, the importance of having clocks in every room in the house. And all of this is associated with the ways in which you must make yourself and your house and your budget calculable, visible, available to management. And so there's all these new temporal rhythms in this new Arab home, new tools like the family budget, new codes of spending and saving and containing the self. And very important to it is the relationship of this domestic manager to her other, the maid. And here is where we see the myth of equality that nationalism often entails, right? Because these reform projects confine the elite women's participation into the walls of this home, but it also trapped the toiling subordinate in this kind of silent underrank that was subject to constant surveillance. So the ideal economic subject, what these men called social man, and their partner, the scientific domestic manager, they were charged with constantly thinking and acting to realize the largest possible profit, to constantly, above all, curb their desires and save. And also, actually, what's central to this, right, is the ways in which all of these proliferating needs, while tempting and while indications of arrival, also threatened social hierarchy. So Salwa Saeed, as she is doing this radio program, the new Arab home, what is she most anxious about? Your maid is going to listen to the program. Be careful she doesn't arrive to a sense of self. And how does she actually, what does she blame this new inculcating of a sense of self? She blames it on the spread of primary schools, the increase in cinema houses, the radio, mixing with foreigners. So these kinds of ways in which what she called the third rank were coming into themselves. So this is a very good indication of how is it that these new availabilities for desire and modern arrival were at once sources of promise and danger. So here I think what is very important then is to see how these elites used needs and notions of needs. So they separated needs based on class. So the worker had simple needs. He could get away with just wearing cheap clothes. The middle class men and women needed, had cultural needs as such as solitary and reflective reading. Right, they had needs for leisure. The very wealthy man needed to travel and needed to spend hundreds on charity, right? So the very kind of understanding of what a need is was class-based and was also a way in which these figures were not only formulating new classes, but were actually attempting to essentialize these differences as somehow natural. Right, and in that sense, really promoting their own social hegemony. So they were not alone in identifying this proliferation of objects as a distinct transition in economic practices. And many scholars of other regions and from diverse perspectives have pointed to how is it that the abundance of commodities and the concept of growth was central to carving out economy as a distinct sphere. So now what I'm going to do is turn to World War II and British colonial regulations in this period, and to really look at actually the main point here is to show that it isn't actually growth as much as it is scarcity and wartime management that drives the British colonial attempt to really regulate, calculate, and make visible economy in new ways. How's everybody doing? Sleepy? Need to jump around? Okay, we're almost there. Okay, so now I'm switching gears and I'm going to be talking about the British colonial efforts and their regional and national projects. Okay, so it's going to feel like a switch of gears because it is. Just hold on to the notion of basic needs and it will make sense, hopefully. So in 1941, the British established a very important venture called the Middle East Supply Center. And basically what the Middle East Supply Center is attempting to do is minimizing allied demands on shipping, labor, and materials, and hopefully in British imperial renditions, ensuring everyone's freedom from want. Okay, this is very important rhetoric in British imperial policy during World War II. And its geographic and numerical renditions of economy have really left behind important legacies. So for those of you, lots of you in the room know, but in 1902, it is an American military historian named Alfred Thayer Mann who first coins the term the Middle East. Okay, and he does this to refer to an area that stretches from the Arabian Peninsula across Iran all the way to the borders of today's Pakistan. And he distinguishes this from what he calls the Near East, which includes the Balkans, Anatolia, and the Eastern Mediterranean. And British colonial officials are actually continuing to use these renditions until World War II. So wartime actually changes how is it that British colonial power understands and defines the regions that they are intervening in. What is happening during World War II is the shutting down of Mediterranean trade and different kinds of bread uprisings all over the Middle East, ranging from Tehran to Oman to Damascus to Beirut. And the British are freaking out because they know that if people are out on the streets because they are hungry, this is going to mean a great deal of political havoc and potential for uprising. They create something called the Middle East Supply Center in which they re-envision what it is to talk about the Middle East that now includes 27 territories ranging from Malta to Sudan and including 100 million people. And in the short period of time, they become the buyer and supplier of all goods in this region. And they're really attempting to forge a kind of unitary Middle East, okay? And they're really credited for providing indices and calculations and legislation where none was present before. But what's been interesting to me in comparison to the iqtisadiyat that I showed you is actually people did have regional renditions of economic units that were meant to ensure capitalist investment in the future, which looked quite different from the British Middle East Supply Center, which would later become also a US, it started out as a British venture, it would later become Anglo-American. So what does this mean in Palestine? So their attempts are not just regional. There's a very important Egyptian story in this context too, which I don't get to, but also in the book, but there's a lot of interesting people working on it. What it means for Palestine is the introduction of numerous regulations that are basically trying to govern what people eat, the size of their food, how and when they eat it, okay? And basically what takes place in this period is a state structure, one of the most important state structures, which is called the provision of essential needs or food control, what Palestinians and European Jews called an army of bureaucrats that were attempting to regulate everybody's food intake. Okay. So to give you a sense of that and to link this to the idea of development and the promise of universal indices, I'm going to talk to you about one of the indices that the British colonial effort used to try and ensure food for all. So this is an image from 1896 when the American scientist Wilbur Atwater invented the calorie meter. And along with categories of fats, carbohydrates, proteins, this invention made food a politically legible object. And the study of food was now called nutrition. It was inextricable from the measurement of basic needs and poverty. And basically what takes place, and this is a very interesting and important story of the history of the index of the cost of living, which appears to us now as somehow a natural and self-evident index, when actually it's a product of great historical struggle. What happens in the late 19th century is that US-based nutritionists who are desperately looking for backing for their new science that no one wants to believe them on make alliances with economic elites who are trying to keep all the labor unrest at bay. And they come together and they say, what is the basic minimum that people need so that they can eat enough so that we can keep them on the factory floor and not out on the streets? That's how the cost of living comes into play. Right? And what happens here is that there is a very big debate about explaining how do we think about hunger, how do we think about malnutrition. And nutritionists are in a big debate. Some of them say these are structural conditions. They're the product of inequalities. Other people say, no, this is a moral failing. It is the problem of the hungry that they are hungry. It is the fault of the poor for being impoverished, right? This should be familiar to us in the kind of Trump moment we are living now. So these kinds of questions around how do we understand this political object of nutrition are unifying debates across colonial and imperial lines. So some of the debates that are taking place in London are also taking place in Jerusalem. And this is, I think, a really, really important paradigm to understand. Also important is that nutrition is part of a broader movement called colonial development. Usually the way we understand development is with Truman's famous speech in 1949. That's when development supposedly comes into being, right? But actually, colonial development has a much longer history, and it is the French and the British who are basically reacting to broad uprisings throughout their colonies in Africa, East Asia, and the Middle East in the 1930s, in which they are now linking social welfare to economic growth in new ways. And so historians like Frederick Cooper and Zachary Lockman have talked about how in the 1930s, the British and the French begin thinking, okay, we need to start thinking about this thing called colonial development. Maybe we should establish departments of labor so we can co-opt these radicals so that they don't go to the nationalists, right? So we can bring them into the state. A crucial part of that turn to development was nutrition and was notions of social welfare. And this is part of what my work attends to. An important other portion of this is that it is in the interwar period where you see people like Herbert Hoover, who is at that time the head of the US National Food Authority, his contemporary John Maynard Keynes, and these guys are actually linking basic needs to issues of national security. If we don't give our soldiers enough food, we're going to lose the wars. Okay? And so World War II, and despite these realizations that are happening just in the interwar period, it's up until the 1930s, and this is one of the things that makes me feel less depressed about our current political moment, is that in 1936 in the House of Commons in London, they had an 11-hour debate on whether or not there was a link between poverty and malnutrition. There was an actual 11-hour stalemate debate, right? But what makes these stark realities something that people can no longer turn away from? World War II. It is then that it becomes readily apparent to the British imperial war effort that if we do not actually begin providing for basic needs, and we do not take caloric intake seriously, we are going to be in even deeper trouble than we already are. Now, the biggest example of British colonial mismanagement in this period, the most actually devastating, was in Bengal in 1943, when an estimated 3 million people died from famine. The British record in Palestine is actually much better. And I'll be happy to talk a bit more about the kinds of rationing attempts that they basically instituted in Mandate Palestine during this period. But what I want to tell you a little bit about is a survey that they commissioned in this period. And they go through several different rationing regimes that all fail because they basically cannot categorize all the differences in Mandate Palestine. They don't know how to box in these people, okay? And so one of the ways that this really comes to fore is an important survey that is commissioned on what the British are calling a nutritional economy. It's run by a man named Vickers, who is basically arguing that people are living better than ever before. The British colonial project is doing very well. 73% of Arab families had moved up the highest levels of expenditures, right? He bases his survey on what he calls three racial expenditure groups: Arabs, Oriental Jews, and European Jews, right? And what's very funny about this, of course, in this period, is that in the beginning, he actually tries to subdivide Arabs into Muslims and Christians. And then he sort of stops and he says, well, there's no important differences in these diets, so we can't actually survey these differences. And so one of the interesting ways is that how commonalities between Palestinian Muslims, Christians, and Jews really troubled the internal coherence of these two separate races, the Arab and the Jew. So at the end of the day, it's actually a very gloomy picture, right? This survey and many other British official documents are really trying to paint a very rosy picture of British colonialism. But in fact, the reason that people are moving up the expenditure ladder is because they're spending more on food than anything else, because that's how crazy the inflation is during the war. And these rationing schemes tell us a lot about the failures of the colonial project in Palestine. One, they tried to introduce the metric system and it fails altogether because there is a kind of mobile regional measuring system in the Middle East that is still in place until today, where the south of Palestine is measuring amounts more similarly, for example, to Egypt, and the north is measuring amounts more similarly to the Lebanese south, right? So they really fail in terms of even weighing and measuring goods. They also fail in terms of counting people, because they cannot, again, find the neat categories in which to create these politics of calculability. Also, what I think is most important, and this gets us back to what we should commemorate very proudly today, which is International Women's Day and women's struggle to be women and live in dignity. What these nutritional surveys actually really show, they challenge us on some comfortable binaries. So here we see how the approach to poverty as this incurable expression of moral weakness actually unites depictions of the poor in Britain and the native and or the Oriental that is backward in Palestine. Also important is the much maligned figure of the homemaker, who transcends these divides of the colonizer and the colonized, right? And if we are to take British colonial surveys at their word, we find that most nutritional, health, and budgetary problems in 20th century Palestine were a result of bad cooking, inadequate mothering, and ignorant housekeeping, whether Arab or Jewish. And so the domestic manager in Palestine, just as she was in Britain, was always the last to eat and the first to garner responsibility for managing hunger. So I'm going to conclude. And I want to just suggest what these various renditions of basic needs tell us about these Palestinian elites, colonial rule, and the idea of universal categories. First, these projects reveal how the crafting of the home as a space of contained consumption worked as a stratification process. And here I'm very interested in the ways that class and culture are elided, right? And the ways in which those two things become synonymous, until today, in even in language. And what I'm very invested here in is suggesting that these elites were not simply attempting to make distinctions, but to ensure them as stable and unchanging essences. Second, in addition to complicating, as I've said, the flattened topography, what is at stake here is a critique of the Arab liberal project. And what I would like to suggest, and what I suggest in the book, is that we cannot only think of these Palestinians as shadows of the colonial other. They weren't just in conversation with the British colonial officer and the European Jewish settlement. They had a broader conversation that was going on. That broader conversation, it has come time, really, it's urgent to stop idealizing that so-called interwar liberal age and begin critiquing it. Because at that time, what I'm suggesting is that it was not simply or coincidentally exclusionary. The project is contingent on exclusion. And the poor and the hungry were then, as they are today, either invisible in utopic landscapes of progress or the very personification of ugliness to be reformed as supplements, not as actors in history. Thank you. I'm happy to take questions. Oh. Yeah, yeah. Yes.
I was wondering if you could talk more about the educational background of the men who were being spied out. Were they going to Ottoman state-run schools that were being found?
So some of them are going to Ottoman schools. Some of them are going to the Seba himself goes to the American University in Beirut. A couple of them get their education from Paris. Some of them go to Cairo. So they're really understanding themselves as bringing together all the multiple influences of the areas around them. So I would often get this question, well, why are you making so much of these group of people who are basically inconsequential? and my response to that is, after 1948, they're actually not inconsequential at all. They're really at the vanguard of this kind of new entrepreneurial sort of, you know, effervescence, but also that they're really understanding themselves as at the intersections of multiple universes of discourse. So this is the other thing that I find really compelling about them, is they're reading Smith and Marx and Ghazali and Ibn Khaldun, and they're putting all of these thinkers in conversation with each other, in part drawing on all these multiple kinds of influences that they have. Yes?
What is their response to the sort of top-down British system that comes into place? Like, are they just like,
So what happens, and this is the part I cut out because I felt like I was going on for way too long. What happens in the 1940s is that they really begin organizing, in particular, institutions of the Arab Chambers of Commerce, which is actually where my research began. Because I started running across all these references to these institutions that I hadn't really seen studied in the Palestine Mandate period. And what is happening in this period is that their understandings of, they begin organizing against the British. They begin seeing themselves as the vanguard of organizing against these colonial renditions, these colonial regulations, which they understood as essentially being the precursor to their national dispossession. They really understand these economic regulations as paving the way for what would happen in 1948. And they begin organizing in multiple different strategies. They actually attempt to even do some forms of mass mobilizing. What happens also intellectually and theoretically is they are no longer talking about a regional Arab economy. Now they begin talking about a smaller Arab economy against a smaller Jewish economy within Palestine. So their territorial visions road. And they also begin to understand that the maid, the worker, and the peasant who are in all of these renditions cannot be the reader or the consumer or the subject, right? They can only be the ghosts that are haunting them. They realize by the 1940s, oh, it's time that we actually start talking to these people, because they start talking about them as these are the real authentic Palestinians. And by that time, it's too little too late to actually affect any kind of vertical organizing and mobilizing that is cross-class. Yes?
So you mentioned that nutritionists had a hard time agreeing on how many calories you need. Uh-huh. Were their estimates close to what we know today? If they even reached...
Well, this is actually, I mean, I spent chapter three doing this, and I had this in this talk too. What actually winds up happening, and the reason that this is really important to me, is because these indices become racialized. So the way that they happen in the United States is that they position the laborer as white, native-born male. And then when the calorie travels to the League of Nations, the precursor to the United Nations, they actually define different caloric needs based on Western versus Eastern needs. And so they identify people in the East as being vegetarian in mind, as less active. And so what you actually see is a much lower caloric bare minimum for the Easterner versus the Westerner. And this is the point that I think is very compelling about these things, is that while we may be invested in these universal categories as giving us a guideline to how do we affect equality, we also have to understand how their very constitution were, how their history, how they came into being was racialized, was influenced by understandings of civilizational superiority, right? This is development promises sameness, but if we are to look at its history, we see how exclusion was part and parcel of how it came into being. Hi, Ahmed.
Hi. Thank you so much. So I just kind of following up on that, I was just curious, but you mentioned that basically that system fell apart and broke down during the war. I'd love to hear more about that.
About which system?
The nutritional division. They weren't able actually to buy.
Well, what they actually do is they institute three different forms of rationing in Palestine during the war, and each of them fails. And in part, they fail because, so they first do what's called just a straight rationing system. And they give out rations based on the category of Arab, Jew, and other, okay? That doesn't work. So then they say, okay, because of course there's a proliferating informal economy in this period, as you can imagine, because this always happens when people are attempting to formalize the economy and put rules on it. Automatically, everything that escapes, you know, I mean, the formalization of economy creates the informal economy and the need for it, right? So then they start another crazy system, which they call the municipal markets, in which they think that they are going to be able to manage the distribution and marketing of all goods. Totally fails. Then they go into a system called the point system, which is one of these kind of leading colonial experts named E.M.H. Lloyd, who is credited for introducing this system in the United States and in Britain, which actually the League of Nations feels very proud of because it is sort of a precursor to consumption as democracy, and you can use points as if money, and then people can, you know, gather points. And so in this attempt, they were attempting to account for differences in taste between Tel Aviv and Buck, for example, right? This also fails desperately. But one of the things I think that is really important, I mean, one of the chapters in the book is called The Vegetable Racket, which is my favorite chapter and which was like the most painful thing I have ever done in my life, because I had a file of 1,000 documents that killed me. They were so tedious and boring. But it's actually the story of how the British think that they can control every single vegetable from the farm to the market and how deeply they fail. So one of the things that I think is important for me about this project that I learned was to really try and resist the temptation of the colonial panopticon and how compelling it could be that the colonial strategy works and oppresses, and yes, it is oppressive, but it's sometimes just as oppressive in its incoherence and its messiness and its incapacity to do anything close to what they think they can do. Yes.
My name is Wissam. I'm from Palestine and I'm a visiting scholar at MIT. I'm just wondering whether if you want to compare, if you were to compare the role of the elite in the past and nowadays,
uh-huh.
is there any, do you see any differences?
Mm-hmm. So I think that one of the reasons that I am invested in this project is because I'm really tired of the way that after 1993, people began talking about Palestinian capitalists as if the story begins in Oslo in 1993, and that really makes me mad. And this is part of the ways in which the Israeli settler colonial project actually influences how we understand Palestine epistemologically, so that we actually begin the story in 93. Maybe we begin the story in 67. Maybe we begin it in 1948, as if there is no prehistory, right? Or not even prehistory. That whole term is, you know, crap. Anyhow, but sorry, I want to say another word, but I thought I shouldn't upset Lerna. so. I think there are part of the reason that I wanted to do it was because I wanted to understand how is it that Arab elite liberalism works as an exclusionary project. And I'll come out and say that I turned the manuscript in as the Sisi regime massacre of the Rabaa Square was happening in 2013. And that was a moment of real crisis for me, because I saw a lot of, I was in Egypt at the time, and I saw a lot of my self-defined liberal colleagues, friends, cohorts, mentors justifying or denying the massacre. People who call themselves liberals. And I was just like, what is this? And I began to see some of the violent exclusionary practices within these economic ideas and projects. Now, at the same time, what I think is important to say is that the men that I study, Saba, Katan, Hasib Sabbagh, all of these people, are different from the kind of capitalists that we see today, in the sense that they had a project that was not beholden. They did not position themselves as subcontractors of occupation, of settler colonialism. They understood themselves as part of a broader Arab regional project, and they had a national project, right? And that I would distinguish between what we have in the West Bank in particular today. And Gaza is interesting too, because a lot of people will talk about the quote unquote resistance economy, but there's also really interesting research about how the Hamas's use of the tunnel economy actually monopolized commercial and enterprise away from many of the historic commercial classes within Gaza. You know, and people think of the tunnel economy as primarily being about arms, but in fact, everything passes through the tunnel economy, from animals to tools to cars to, you know, when Hamas took it over in 2007, it went from making $36 million a year to $36 million a month. And what was interesting to me in relation to my story about the politics of calculation is that Hamas quickly realized, okay, we're going to have to put customs, excise regulations on all of these so we can control it. So I think that there are commonalities and differences that we have to trace. You know, I think we have to honor the differences, but I think we have to critically look for the continuities. And I think for Palestinians, because we continue to be under siege, and for those of us in the diaspora, we continue to be denied our basic right of return, I think we are often so busy with putting our case forward that we don't have enough time to do the necessary self-critical work of our own history that will perhaps allow us to envision new futures together. Yes?
I'm wondering if you could bridge those two moments between, say, 1948 mm-hmm. and 1993. What are the moments then of epistemic rupture where this idea of a connected set of Arab economies then is eroded or erased? And what happens to the vision of domination?
In Palestine, or whatever becomes of Palestine. I mean, Well, this is really interesting because then it's a whole period of dispersal. So I think you have the story of the Palestinians inside Israel that I think we have a lot of kind of new accounts of, Citizen Strangers by Shira Robinson and other work, some of Ilana Feldman's work as well. So I think that's going on inside Palestine. I think also the story of capitalists in the West Bank post-48 is a really important one and its relationship to the East Bank. The story of a commercial class in Gaza and what comes of it, especially as Gaza primarily becomes such a space for refugees. I think that's a really important story. I think the story, I'm not sure, but I think that the story that I'm telling continues as a story in primarily the Lebanese, Jordanian, Iraqi, and Arabian Peninsula diaspora communities, where you see, something that would be really interesting for people to look at is what is the relationship between, the folks who are bankrolling Fatah, right? These capitalists who are bankrolling Fatah, right? How are these guys thinking about armed rebellion? Right, and their commitment to profit and free trade, because that's certainly taking place, right? And I think that's a really interesting history. And I think, the domesticity stuff, it's harder to really track that, but I know, as I said, as I was sort of going through this, suffering through the New Arab Home and this Salwa Saeed and her, didactic, prescriptions. And I think the reason that I was suffering through it is because actually I saw so much of my own self in it. And I understood so clearly that all of these things, she wasn't creating it. She was building on, I think, a longer legacy of Ottoman domesticity and Eastern Mediterranean domesticity. And I think we have still a lot of these really urgent kind of questions. And people like Tanya Fort have asked those around domesticity and consumption more recently. And I think those are really useful sort of moments to get back to. But in terms of economic history, we really don't have a history. You know this because I've said this to you and so many times. But we really don't have a history of economic thought in the Arab world or in the Middle East. And I think it's really high time we take it seriously. And I think we need to do it. I think we need to understand, we sort of take it for granted. I think a lot of people on the so-called left sort of, oh, yeah, those guys don't have ideology. We don't need to take them seriously. They have ideology. They have genealogy. They read philosophy. They understand and have, conceptions of those things. It's kind of like the right in this country. Like, oh, we don't need to. Those guys are just stupid. Well, okay. Fine. If that makes you feel better, great. But it doesn't substitute for taking them seriously, I think. Yes, Said.
Gina, I have two questions. Thank you so much. Super fascinating. The first is, as you talked about colonial development and as I read the parts on caloric calculations, etc., I'm haunted by the kind of ghosts of Gaza, like today, and how Israel, given the siege on Gaza, and Israel conducts caloric calculations as to how many calories people need in order to survive but to barely stay alive. Mm-hmm. So there's a kind of colonial logic today vis-a-vis nutrition that context, and then the context you described. So I wonder if you think there are any continuities between the British and the Israeli colonial logics in this respect, or maybe what are the differences? And then the second question is, I'm sympathetic to your project in terms of critiquing the Arab liberal project in this context, and these Palestinian capitalists. And I understand your point about exclusion, reifying social hierarchies, etc. But I guess my question is, what is the alternative? Like, if we could go back in time, and maybe this could help us figure out elites today, what they could be doing differently. But during that era, what were their alternatives? And what could they have done, I guess, to not be critiqued in the same way today? How could they have not been complicit.
What could we have told them? Yes. They wouldn't have listened to us. They wouldn't have listened to us. I think that would be. So I had actually an epilogue in for this book, a piece that I wrote online called Counting Calories and Making Lemonade in Gaza, in which I argue precisely as you have that there is this continuity between the ways in which after 2007, the Israeli occupation and authority over the siege of Gaza, as was disclosed by the Israeli non-governmental organization Gisha, had actually set the basic limits of caloric intake that Gazans would need in order to not starve, to be just hungry enough but not starve, okay? And these were the kinds of measurements that the Israeli authorities were making in the hopes that people would uprise against Hamas. Of course, this didn't work in part because this is the moment that Hamas is also flourishing the tunnel economy. So the argument that I make there is the way that, you know, many of us probably in this room, I don't know, I do, I think of the calorie as a way to survey myself almost a lot, but it's also a tool of governance, and the British used it, the Israelis used it, and in the face of this sort of position that Hamas had between being humanitarian subjects on the one hand, subjects of humanitarianism in conversation with your work, and objects of Israeli surveillance, they chose to do the tunnel economy, right, and really use this kind of possibilities. And actually, what's interesting is they begin to envision a tunnel economy that is pan-Arab. Oh, we'll go, we'll get all the way to Morocco, and we'll have like a whole tunnel horizon of pan-Arabism. Of course, that doesn't work. And part of the reason that it doesn't work is because the Israelis can turn the switch at any time on all of Gaza, like literally turn off all of the electricity at whatever moment. So, yeah, I think there are continuities and technologies that are really instructive. And I think the idea of calculation as a tool of rule is really important. And this is why it's also important to keep in mind how Hamas is also doing that, to marginalize and isolate the historical commercial class that's in Gaza. What would we have told these guys? I mean, so, you know, I kind of come from these people, so it's not like, do you know what I mean? It's part of the reason I wrote this work. Like, these are the people, these are the class that I come from. So these aren't the very wealthy, but they're kind of pulling themselves up. They're not like the very wealthy, big landowning families, but they're getting education and they're entrepreneurial. And so, I had a lot of fear because I had Fuad Saba's grandson was very generous with me, and I really hoped that he wouldn't read the book as a critique of his grandfather, you know, because I am invested in sort of retrieving these actors as important historical figures. At the same time, I think that we have to think critically about the failures of Arab liberalism, the failures of the Arab left, and I think not just in Palestine, but more broadly, what has happened is this kind of convention of who do these people understand as full subjects that can be part of these conversations, that can be part of these solidarities, that can be part of mobilizing and envisioning the future. This is the major critique. That, as I said in response to Emily's question, that they begin doing this in the 1940s, they start understanding, oh no, we have to talk to the peasants and the nomads and the workers. But by that point, it's too late. And in fact, the Arab revolt is as much of a social revolution as it is at one against British colonialism and Zionist settlement, right? So I think as we move forward, I think that we really have to pose these questions about full membership, about the full subject, about who can speak. And you know, we are involved in these struggles, right? And then I also think, you know, for the history of mass mobilization more broadly and the history of the left, right, in the Arab world, there have been key moments, you know, whether it's the socialist movement in Syria or the communist movement in Iraq, where the kind of balances and trade-offs with authoritarian regimes always proved brutal, right? And always sort of served to really empty politics of these very political projects. I don't know what I'd say to them. I'm not sure they'd listen to me, but they may listen to you. They may have listened to you if we could, but maybe not. Yes, sir.
Are the contemporary systems of calorie regulation in the Gaza Strip racialized? Is there some racial division for the rationing?
No, it's just about people in Gaza, as far as I know. The full report on it is by an organization named Gisha. And you can find the full report online, and you're welcome to email me, and I can send you more information about that. But, you know, what is racialization is the question. I think racialization, especially in this particular moment that we're living in the United States today, in light of Black Lives Matter, in light of sort of this ongoing state-sanctioned targeting of black and brown bodies, I think really makes it urgent that we think about the histories of racialization critically as constructing, again, you know, your question about the very category of the calorie. So it's not in Gaza necessarily, although I would perhaps argue that Israeli understandings of what is the Gazan subject are itself racialized. Halas? Yes?
I'm still trying to understand the distinction that you made between the economic elite and the political elite,
uh-huh.
and like how it relates. Like, mm-hmm. Is it like you're trying to say how it relates to the way things got shaped after, like before and after 1948? Or so basically, I just like want to hear more about what.
That's a really good question. So I guess I would say that there's two. So first, what I'm trying to do is disaggregate what we think of as the elite. So I don't do enough the kind of. So I'm not suggesting that here are the lines where we can say these are the political elites and these are the economic elites. The guys I'm studying are really trying to do that. And that's their modernist project. They're saying, we're not men of politics. We're men of capital. So we take care of business. And in part, it's because they're totally fed up with the guys who are running the political show, right? Now, the second part of your question, which is, had these people had more of a say, would things have been different, right? It's hard for me to say, but since my critique is actually of, you know, I guess what I'm saying is their projects were exclusionary. What political potential they could have had, they foreclosed them in the ways in which they weren't able to organize in a vertical way, right? They could only organize cross-class. They could only speak to one another. By the 1940s, when crisis is so apparent to them in economic terms because of the British regulations, that's when they begin thinking in different ways. But by then, it's too late. And in a sense, it mirrors some of the limitations of the formal political leadership. Much of the story that we tell about, for example, thankfully now, you know, scholars, beginning with Ted Swedenborg, but more recently with people like Charles Anderson, have really proven that the revolt was not as scholars used to suggest, which was that it was an elite instigated revolt. Actually, what happened was a mass uprising that was rural, that was grassroots, that then the formal political leadership had to find ways to try and lead, right? So I guess maybe this gets back to your question, which is that the potential for popular sovereignty, the potential for demands, Palestinian demands for popular sovereignty, I think were rich. I think we're deep. I think we're profound in the same ways that we can see the potential for popular sovereignty in the Arab uprisings that took place. And I think both these economic elites and the political elites failed entirely to understand the potential of that mobilizing, and saw in it more of a challenge to their own social power than the possibility of a different political outcome. Yes?
I have a question about the current elites in Palestine,
uh-huh,
and the economic elites, and how are they affecting the Palestinian Authority, or how is the Palestinian Authority affected by them, and how is that going to affect the independence of Palestinian economy from the Israeli economy, and would we be able at any point of time to have that economy independent?
So I guess I would start out by saying the way that we talk about Palestine as somehow now the West Bank is one of the epistemic violences of 1993, right? The way that the West Bank has somehow now become Palestine is one of those violences. I think, you know, this isn't going to be a newsflash to anybody. The two-state solution is dead in the water. It's never going to happen. Oslo has ensured that. The Palestinian economic class in the West Bank and Gaza is hand-in-hand with the Palestinian Authority, which has signed on to be a subcontractor of the Israeli occupation. Those are the limits that we are in. Looking for independence within that, it's going to be very difficult. I think we have to begin looking outside that system of the Oslo negotiations and the Palestinian Authority in order to think about a future that includes Palestinians who are not just residents of the West Bank, but Palestinians who are in Gaza, Palestinians who remain confined to refugee camps all over the Arab world, and Palestinians in diaspora like you and I. And the best person to read about this is Raja Khalidi, who has written a great deal about Oslo and economic regulations and the relationship between the Palestinian Authority and Israel, which was from the get-go. I mean, the Paris protocols are very important in this regard. The possibility of a Palestinian independent economy was foreclosed from the very beginning. Sorry to be so gloomy, but what can we say? Yeah, it's a gloomy reality.
Any other urgent questions? I would like to thank Sherene.
Thank you
for this wonderful talk and discussion.
Thank you. Thank you so much.